You can see okay? Okay. We were looking at the map, how random is the map A goes to A bar mod P for P, a large prime, right? And we define this measure nu P is this Dirac mass, AP is a delta spike at the pair A over P, A bar over P, normalized to be a probability measure. And the claim is that this, so claim is that this converges weakly, weak star converges to Haar measure, Lebesgue measure on the torus. Lebesgue on the torus, R mod Z squared. Or at least that's what we, I don't know if we claimed it, but certainly the data that we looked at, the pictures suggested this strongly. And so so what is nu of nu P of F, by which I mean the integral of F d nu, which we could also write as the inner product of nu with F. I mean, this is a pairing. That is exactly this evaluated on F. So F is in, let's say, smooth functions on the two torus. So what we do is we sum over A mod P, coprime to P, so that we can invert, so that A bar, it makes sense. F of these this pair of points divided by P minus one. So far, so good. Okay. Now, let's look at, so by Parseval, this is the same as the inner product of the Fourier transforms. You want to tell us what the question is, or?
No, I mean, I guess we're discussing why would anyone write nu p comma f instead of just writing integral of f d nu p. And really, it's a matter of notation, but it's very nice because right now you literally saw why it's nice, because you can pass to the Fourier transform side. So of course, it's better to have it in your mind that this is some sort of inner product. So yeah, that was what we're discussing. I'm sorry for
interrupting. Great. No, not at all. Please, please do interrupt. That we're here to talk. So this is a sum. Okay, so what do I mean here by this Fourier transform and this inner product? On what space is this an inner product? We're only measuring F on Z mod P squared. And nu is only a function on Z mod P squared. Even though F really takes values in the two torus, the only place where we are evaluating the values of F is on the mod P points. And so this inner product, what I mean is a sum over M and N mod P, all M and N of nu P M N F hat of M N M N. And let's specify that this is the P hat. So F hat P of M N is the modular, is a sum over A and B mod P of F of A over P, B over P times E to the 2 pi I A over P M plus B over P N, maybe with a bar. Okay, so all I'm saying is that if you, and what is nu? Nu is the same thing. And nu hat P of M N is this sum for nu, but nu is this. So the only thing that survives is one over P minus one, a sum over A coprime to P, and then E, well, I guess with bars, although, fine, I'll put the bars, A, M plus B, N. And B, the whole point is that B is A bar N. Okay, in other words, just take this and this, and sum them, multiply them, and sum over M and N. And I guess I need a bar on one of them. There we go. And the only thing that will survive is exactly this formula. There's a normalizing factor, 1 over p squared, that I need for this to come out. So do you guys do you buy this? You stick this in for f. You stick this in for nu hat. You sum over m and n. And the only thing that survives is the case where a is equal to a, and b is equal to a bar, which is exactly this sum. And that's what this 1 over p squared summed over m and n is doing. So far, so good. Okay. Now, you have a spectral, so we've taken sort of a spectral expansion of this inner product. Whenever you have a spectral expansion, there's one term that's going to be the main term. Where will the main term come from here?
M and N are zero?
Exactly. So one term is M and N are zero. So I have nu hat of zero, zero. F, this prime, this P transform of M N of zero, zero, of zero, zero. And there's this factor of 1 over P squared. Plus the sum over MN, not both zero, of the same thing. Okay. What is nu hat of zero, zero? If M and N are zero, nu hat of zero, zero is one. And what is FP hat of zero, zero? So if this is zero, zero, I'm summing FP on A over P, B over P. And here's this normalizing factor, 1 over P squared, that now enters this sum. So this, go ahead, Leonidas.
Yeah, it's some sort of average of the values of F as A and B ranges.
In fact, if you average the values of A over P, B over P on F, and P gets larger and larger, that is a discrete approximation to
the integral. I have a question. When did the sum became from sum prime to sum not prime, right? Because it was...
So nu is a sum over the primes, but it takes values in Z mod P in the Z mod P squared points of the two torus. So I have the full two torus. This is T2. But then I have the Z mod P squared values of it, which is this grid. So this only takes values on the grid points. And so F will only ever sample the values of F on these grid points. And so this inner product is taking place in this space. So when we dualize, the dual to that space is just itself, Z mod P, but it's the full Z mod P squared. Okay, so I'm just opening this as a function on Z mod P squared. So I have a sum over all A and B, and here I have a sum over all A and B, but the only A and B that contribute to the sum on nu is the ones where B is equal to A bar. So that's why this is a single sum, whereas this is a double sum, just because of the nature of nu. And then the inverse transform is summed over all M and P, M and all M and N. The term MN equals zero contributes something that approaches asymptotically the total measure of F, because you're sampling F on these grid points, but the grid is getting finer and finer. And it's a probability measure. So what we have to know is that the rest of the sum, okay, 1 over p squared times the rest of the sum goes to zero. So need this to go to zero. And then this inner product will asymptotically capture the measure of f. And so nu of f will go to the measure of f. Okay. Very good. Here we have the Kloosterman sum. Well, with the bar. So this is S of minus M minus N P. This is the Kloosterman sum. That's just what it's called. And the reason we started looking at it is because this is the modular version, modular analog to the K-Bessel function. If you remember, K-Bessel was a sum of something times, it was an integral over, which was an integral e to the minus some parameter u plus 1 over u. So this is a plus 1 over a with some parameters. Okay. So far, so good? Okay. Let's look at this Kloosterman sum. So we need bounds for Kloosterman sums. When you have a sum like this and you want to bound it, so need bounds for Kloosterman sum. The most naive thing you could try to do is, how do you bound this thing by itself? So the trivial bound, what's the trivial bound? Let's start there. Trivial bound.
Triangular inequality.
Triangle inequality. S, M, N, P is bounded by 1 over P minus 1, a sum over A mod P of, well, if I put absolute values here, of 1. But there's P minus 1 thing, so this is bounded by 1. Now, that's not good enough. This is bounded by 1, and there's P squared terms and a 1 over P squared. So this just fails to be enough. Okay.
Wait, is the Kloosterman sum just the sum term or including the 1 over P minus 1 factor?
It does not include, I'm sorry. It does not include the 1 over P minus 1 factor traditionally. So this is bounded by P minus 1. And that's just not enough when you put it back into here to get any cancellation. So we need any non-trivial cancellation over to capture cancellation in these things for fixed MN as A ranges, we get a bunch of numbers of absolute value 1. Should we see what this really looks like? Okay, so let's sum e to the 2 pi I a m plus power mod a inverse mod p n. So let's say m is equal to n. And n is equal to m and n are equal to 1, and p equals, I don't know, 1001, or let's take the thousandth prime, whatever that is, thousandth prime. And so this is, okay, and then
Professor, can you zoom somehow?
Yes, I'm sorry. Let's make that much bigger so you can see. How's that? Okay, so as A ranges from 1 to P minus 1, I have this list. And of course I have to divide by P. So I have this list of a bunch of roots of unity. Okay, let's make a much smaller list so you can actually see what's going on. Okay, so 29 is the 10th prime. And when I take e to the 2 pi I a m plus a inverse n over P, let's say m and n are 1, I get all these roots of unity. And so if I take the partial sums of this, it's partial sums, partial, no. So how about, how about I make a table, which is a sum of this as A goes from 1 to B. And that sum will be a table as B goes from 1 to P minus 1. So this is a table of the partial sums. So I start with the first term, then the first two terms, and the first three terms, and so on. Okay? And to really see what this looks like, so let's apply, let's make these into pairs. And then I think I can just list plot these pairs. And let's make it connected. Style, is it style? No. Plot style. Let's say dashed. No. Anybody know how to make this connected? Connected equals true.
Like list line plot? No, right? That's probably line. Not what you want.
I don't know. I just wanted to, there we go. There we go. Okay. So we start with, let's say B goes from 0 to P minus 1, just so that we see where we start. Okay, so we start with the origin. And every time we add a new term, every new term here is a number of size 1.
We lost it. But there we go. Now it's back.
Well, I was showing you back to the Kloosterman side.
Oh, I see.
So as A ranges from 1 to P minus 1, every time I add another root of unity. So I start with 0, I add one root of unity, I add another root of unity, and so on. And all these roots of unity are doing something really crazy and winding up with, here's the actual value of the Kloosterman sum. Okay, so the final value, how does the final value compare? Let's see how the final value. Here's the final value going up to P minus 1. And what is it? What's the numerical value and how does it compare to 29? It's of size 5, negative. So it's right here, this final endpoint. Turns out it's real. That's just an accident. And there's a 29 here.
I was about to ask. This one, it's like symmetric around minus 2 point something.
Yeah, let's change that 1 to a 2. So now it looks like that.
Well, it's still symmetric. Now it still looks like it ends at, it's still real in the end.
Yeah, well, there is a symmetry. Okay, so there is a symmetry. A goes to A inverse.
Yeah, I was about to ask. So it's...
There's some sort of like square root cancellation here.
Well, that's exactly what, yes, that's exactly what we're getting to.
Any root we add, we also add its bar.
Anything that we add, we also add its bar. So indeed, right. It is real.
Yeah, that's what it looks like to me.
Very good. And let's take a larger prime. Uh-oh. And this is what the walk looks like. And then we wind up at, we started with the prime 541. So this is how long the walk is. And it ends up at a number of size 33. And just out of curiosity, what is the square root of P numerically? I have to rerun the whole thing. Okay, and the square root of P is 23. So, it's less than twice the square root of P. Let's keep that in mind. Okay, so this is what a Kloosterman, this is what the partial sums of the, this is what a Kloosterman walk looks like. And the question is, you know, when we estimated it trivially, we said just walk once for every number out to 541. So 541 is all the way out here. And this number is much, much smaller than that. All right. So we need to get capture cancellation in these exponential sums. Exponential sum. So we have a sum of a bunch of things of absolute value at 1. And we want to know that when we end up much, much closer to the origin than had we walked straight out by all ones. Okay, so idea is to embed this in the family. Embed in a family, in particular, let's take a moment. Take a moment. What do I mean by a moment? I mean, if we sum over all possible values of K and L mod P of S, M, N, P raised to some power, let's take a second moment. Let's take a second moment. That's a natural thing to take, as you'll see in a second. One of the terms, sorry, that's a K and an L. One of the terms of this sum is S, M, N, P itself squared. So we've embedded it in a family, the family of all of these sums, and we've taken a second moment. This seems like a horrible thing to do. And in fact, it will be a horrible thing to do, but it'll be instructive. Okay, so let's see what happens. So this is a sum over all K and L mod P of, here's the Kloosterman sum, which is a sum over A. Let's see, can I scroll just a little? There we go. A sum over A mod P co-prime, E P of A M plus A bar A K plus A bar L squared. So far, so good? Now, this is a completely standard thing. When you have a sum and a sum squared with a sum inside, open the square. So open the square. And what that means is now we have two variables. We have an A mod P and something else. Let's say a A and a B mod P co-prime. And open the square and, of course, reverse orders. And then we have a sum on K and L mod P. And what's the sum end? So we have an E sub P of A K plus A bar L. And the same thing with a B and a conjugate. That's the nice thing about the absolute value squared. Is the absolute value squared is the thing times its conjugate. So now I have an E sub P of negative BK plus negative B bar minus B bar L. Okay, did everybody follow that? No, Nick. So we started here. This sum on AP squared is the same as a sum on A, a sum on B of the thing and the thing bar.
Okay, yeah, because the only term that will stay is when A and B are equal.
That's about to happen. That's what's about to happen, exactly.
Okay.
But before that, just that we open the square and then we reversed orders on the finite sums.
Okay.
Okay, so we have this sum over A and B, a sum over K and L on the inside, and then the original exponential times the bar of the exponential when summed on B. Okay. And exactly as Nick said, when we sum on K, we get zero unless A is equal to B, in which case we get P. So we get P times the indicator function of A to equal to B. And now when we sum on L, we also get P times the indicator function of A bar being equal to B bar. So when you sum on K, you get a zero unless A and B are equal. When you sum on L, you get zero unless A bar and B bar are equal. But of course, if A and B are equal, then A bar is automatically equal to B bar. And so what do we get in this sum? Just crudely, I don't want to keep factors of p minus, I want to forget about minus ones. So I have a p squared. I have a p squared just from these two terms. And then a sum over a and b, but only on the diagonal. Well, that's easy. Just sum over a and then b is determined. There's only one value of b for which this is non-zero. So if I sum over a, well, there's p minus one values of a. Okay, so then I can't help myself but to put a less than, but it's actually, there's no constant. So far, so good?
So it is not equal. Maybe I misunderstood, but it seemed as if we counted very well.
In fact, okay, so I can't even help myself but to put a less than or equal, but in fact, it's exactly equal to p squared times p minus one. But I can't help but put a couple more lines here just because they're so second nature. Okay, what have we learned? We've learned that this term, now we drop all but one term, which is the term that we cared about, which was embedded into this family, and we took this moment. We learned that S, M, N, P, if I take the square root of both sides, now I'll say is less than, because this is definitely an inequality, and now I'm gonna be a little crude. This is P cubed. The square root of that is P to the 3/2. But the trivial bound is P, not P to the 3/2. So this is bad. This is worse than trivial. Worse than trivial. Okay, it was just a barometer to test this idea. Okay. Well, the second moment didn't work. We shouldn't give up. Let's try the fourth moment. Let's see if we can get more information out of the fourth moment. The fourth moment. What's nice about a fourth moment? Maybe Lewis knows. Why is a fourth? The second moment is obviously very special. It's a Hilbert space. It's very nice.
You're saying what's nice about the fourth moment for the Kloosterman sum?
Or in general, if I have the fourth moment of something, if I have something to the fourth squared, to the fourth and summed over some family, it's the same as the second moment of, it's the second moment squared. It's a sum over F of the square. It's the second moment of the square of the function. Right? I didn't do anything. But the square, the dual, so whatever the dual sum is, the sum over the dual sum, whatever this dual sum is, this, the square function, its transform is the convolution transform. So here I'm using Parseval or Plantrail, whatever. That a sum over a function, over some space is a sum over the dual of the dual, and that the dual of the norm squared is the convolution of the transforms. In other words, the inverse transform of a convolution is the square. So this is just the general principle to keep in mind that will make things a little nice, but let's see what it means in this case. Okay, so again, we're gonna sum over K, let's be very concrete, K and L mod P, S of K L P to the fourth. One of the terms will be S M N P to the fourth. Okay. We open up the not just the square, but the fourth power. And what do we get? So instead of having two sums, A and B, now we get four sums. So we get, I don't know what to call it, A, B, C, D mod P. And then an inner sum of A of K and L mod P. And now what? I have a factor of E. See, two of them will come with so the fourth power is the second power squared. So two of them will come with a plus sign and two of them will come with a minus sign. So I get E P of A K plus A bar L, EP of BK plus B bar L, EP of negative CK minus C bar L, and EP of negative DK minus D bar L. So if I have two sums over A and B, and two sums over the conjugate over C and D, when you multiply that all together, that is the fourth power of the Kloosterman sum. Everybody see that? So far, so good? Okay. All right. We can sum over K and L. The sum over K and L, again, is a factor of P when I sum over K times the indicator of what? So the sum over K will be zero unless the terms that have the K add up to zero. So what's it going to be?
A plus B is equal to C plus D.
Exactly. Okay, and how about the L sum?
It's the same, but with bars, so it's the same.
Let's be a little careful.
Yeah, it's not the same. I was just thinking of a different bar. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So how can it be that two things sum to the same thing and their conjugates sum to the same thing and their inverses sum to the same thing? Let's see if we can get some, if we can count how many points this has. Okay. So now we need to count, the number of solutions to this pair of equations, this system, A plus B is C plus D, A bar plus B bar is C bar plus D bar. This is mod P. Okay, the trivial bound is P to the four because I have four things. But I, of course, I can do much better. Once A and B and C are fixed, then D is of course determined. It's actually P cubed. But P cubed is still not anywhere near good enough for P cubed gives us P to the four, P to the five, P to the five fourths. Okay, so we need to do better. If we fix A and B, so there's P squared choices for A and B, then A bar is fixed and B bar is fixed. Then we're trying to solve, need to count the number of C plus D being something fixed and C bar plus D bar being something fixed. These two things are fixed because A and B, once we've determined the values of A and B, this is just whatever it is, A plus B and A bar plus B bar, those are fixed values, and it's C and D that we're trying to study. Now, one of the terms is A equals negative B. Okay, so let's see, how can we deal with this system? If we take the bottom and we multiply by CD, if we multiply, so of course C and D are invertible, so we have to multiply by CD. This gives me a D plus C equals GCD. No, yeah, that was unintended, GCD. But we know what C plus D is. C plus D is F. So now the pair of equations is C plus D is something fixed, and C times D is, well, something fixed as long as G is not zero. So we have to separate out the case that G is zero. G will be zero if A bar is negative B bar. We're back. Where were we? Which point did I drop off?
Okay, so we have C plus D equals F, and then CD has to be something, and we were talking about that something.
So if G is zero, then we don't have an equation on CD. G is zero happens when, so we have to separate out these P squared choices into A equals negative B or not. A not equal to negative B. If A is equal to negative B, then once you've chosen A, then B is determined. So there's only P choices here, as opposed to when A is not equal to negative B, when again, let's be crude, there's less than P squared choices. Okay. If A is equal to negative B, then G is equal to zero. So here, G is equal to zero. And my only equation is C plus D is equal to F, but F is actually zero also. So once I choose C, D is determined. So choose C, there's P choices. And then D is determined. Okay, so that was one strand. Otherwise, G is not equal to zero. So in this strand, where we start with P squared choices for A and B, then G is not equal to zero. And I can write C times D as FG bar, which again is something else fixed, H fixed. Okay, how do we count the number of solutions to this? Well, let's go over here. So if C times D is equal to H and C plus D is equal to F, then C, or let's say D, D is F minus C. So let's put that in here. I have C times D is F minus C is equal to H. I'm just solving, we're back to grade school. Okay. And so what does this mean? I have a C squared. This means C squared. Let me move that C squared to the other side. So I have a C squared.
Wait, minus, and these are like equivalence classes?
These are, yeah, this is all mod P. Everything's happening okay. Mod P.
So this is like a quadratic reciprocity problem?
It's a quadratic equation mod P. It's a quadratic equation mod P. So I have C squared minus CF plus H equals zero. It's congruent to zero. So I want to know if once I solve this for C, then D is determined. So the question is, how many solutions are there for C? Well, we can write this as, let's complete the square. So P is a large prime. P is not equal to 2. 2 is not a large prime, although it acts, punches above its weight. So I can write this as C minus F times 2 bar squared. So what is that? C times F minus 2 bar squared is C squared minus 2 CF 2 bar. So that's minus CF. That was exactly the point of, so 2 is invertible. That's why I did that. Plus F squared times 4 bar. So I don't want this. So I want to subtract off F squared times 4 bar. That kills off this. And I want to add H. So these two things are equal. This thing is equal to zero. And now, well, how many solutions are there to this? Whatever this is again, is something fixed. This is F squared times four bar plus H is something fixed. So either it's negative as a square or not. Either way, whether it is or not, there's two possible squares for C. And for C minus two bar times F. So there's two possible values for F, for C.
Could there be none?
There could be none, yeah.
Oh, but you're just like crudely bounding?
Crudely bounding it by two. Two values for C. And then once we have C, then D is determined. Then D is determined. And so in total, the number of points, number of possible solutions is bounded by, let's be crude, I'm going to forget about this too. Either A and B are equal, or A is, are negatives, which means we have P choices, and then C has P choices, and then D is determined. Or A and B are not equal, now we have P squared choices for A and B, but then C is determined. And then D is also determined. So either way, we get this bound of P squared. Let's go all the way back. That was counting how many solutions there are in A, B, C, D to this pair of equations. So the whole thing is bounded by P to the 4. So let me write that here. So what we've learned is that the sum, the fourth moment, we've computed the fourth moment. Not only is it bounded, it's actually at least p squared, because you can always take a equals the c and b equals the d, and then this is going to be satisfied. So the fourth moment, we were able to bound above and below by p squared. We only care about the bound from above, but actually you can't do better. Sorry, p squared is a number of solutions, and then there's a factor of p squared from the sum on k and l. So this is p to the 4. We drop all but one term. We take fourth roots. We recover the trivial bound.
Like why, I guess like why doing more moments gives us a more, why did it give us a more precise estimate?
Well, you'll see in a second. So if we drop all but one term, drop all but one. See, the higher the moment, the better chance you have, as long as you can estimate properly what's going on the other side, the better chance you have of taking a large root afterwards. See, I get to take a fourth root of whatever comes out on this side.
Why don't you get something worse when you're like, you're summing over more things? Why don't you get something worse?
And there's a delicate balance. Yeah. So if we go to the sixth moment, now we have A plus B plus C equals C plus, A plus B plus C equals D plus C plus F, and A bar plus B bar plus C bar is equal to D bar plus E bar plus F bar. And then it becomes much more difficult to see what the right variables are to choose. So one set of these just got you nowhere. A is B and A bar is B bar, got you nothing. Two sets got you exactly this P to the 4. And if you get more and more equations like this, it becomes more difficult to see where you're supposed to get the cancellation. Okay, so it turns out that here the fourth moment is right on the balance of a high enough moment to get really, once we chose A and B, C was completely determined, and so was D. So we drop all but one term, and we recover S, M, N, P, fourth root of P to the 4 is bounded by P. Again, trivial. But we couldn't possibly have done any better than trivial bound. Why? Where did we put in that both M and N are not both zero? When M and N are both zero, the answer is P minus one. We can't possibly do better than that if we don't put in added information to distinguish the case. So we need to somehow add the information that M and N are not both simultaneously zero. Otherwise, this is the truth. So no wonder we didn't get better than the trivial bound. How are we going to add that information? Okay, let's say M is not equal to zero. Then look at the Kloosterman sum again, S, M, N, P.
So maybe like a bunch of these have to be the same size if you permute by like Z mod P star or something?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So it's a sum E, P of A, M plus B, N. Okay. Let me make a change of variables. Let me replace A by A times M bar, which I can do because M is not zero, and which I can't do if M is zero. And then let me also multiply by an arbitrary integer K. Okay, so as long as K is not equal to zero, if K is not equal to zero, then this is a permutation of the values of A mod B prime.
Wait, where did the B come from?
I'm sorry, that B is a bar. Thank you. Okay, so this is equal to a sum still over A mod P prime, E P of A M M bar K, so that's just A K, plus A bar. A bar is A bar M K bar. So this is A bar M K bar. In other words, this is the Kloosterman sum S K M K bar P. So in fact, any value of K that's invertible, as long as L is equal to M K bar, is exactly the same value. So that contributes not once. So this value, the absolute value of SMNP contributes not once to this sum. It contributes P minus one times to this sum. Any time K is not equal to zero, there's one value of L that will be equal to MK bar. And so we do drop all but once, but we need to remember the multiplicity. This, so SMNP to the four occurs not once, but with multiplicity P minus one, P of order P in the sum, in the fourth moment. That's only true if M and N are both, if at least one of them is not zero. Only true if at least one of M N is not zero. That's where we're crucially gonna use this non-triviality. And so finally we have P times S M N P to the fourth is bounded by P to the fourth, which means S M N P itself is bounded, if one of these is non-zero, is bounded by P to the three quarters. And this is Kloosterman's argument. This is Kloosterman's, 1920. Seven. This is Kloosterman's argument in a different problem in the circle method, the number of representations of a diagonal quadratic form. He introduced the Kloosterman circle method, 1927, required a non-trivial bound on Kloosterman sums, which he obtained by this method, by exactly this method. Okay, I should say
how much better can be done?
They proves that this is bounded by P to the 1/2. Okay, so I don't know when this is, 1940s. This is the Riemann hypothesis for curves. So the truth is square root, but we get some subconvex bound. Some bound that's a power less than the trivial bound. Okay, this subconvex bound. And of course, that's all we need. Once we have that bound, we stick it all the way back in here. We have a 1 over p squared and then a p to the 3 quarters. So, and then you're summing p squared terms. And so this sum goes to zero. Okay, so that implies any subconvex bound, like the 1/4 savings, this is a 1/4 savings, p to the minus 1/4, subconvex 1/4 savings in the power.
Wait, can you go back up top? I'm a little confused about that sum, the one with the dot, dot, dot.
So the Kloosterman sum is bounded by p to the 3/4. That means when you divide by p, this thing is bounded by p to the 1/4, p to the minus 1/4. the number of terms you're summing here is p squared, and you have a 1 over p squared. So this remainder is bounded by p to the minus a quarter. And p to the minus a quarter, when p gets large, goes to 0. You wanna ask?
Wait again, so the bound that we got for Kloosterman was p to the 3/4.
Yes. So nu hat has 1 over p times p to the 3/4, which is p to the minus 1/4. So we've got the decay of all of the other Fourier coefficients. The 0th Fourier coefficient isn't going anywhere. It's equal to 1, the 0/0th Fourier coefficient. All the other Fourier coefficients are decaying in p.
Oh, the other ones are decaying. How are they decaying?
Well, we just showed that if mn is not equal to 0/0, then nu hat p of mn is bounded by p to the minus a quarter. Because there's a 1 over p normalization factor in front of this p to the 3/4. That's exactly what we saved. This p to the 1/4 is exactly what we saved. So all the other Fourier coefficients are dying. In the limit, it's becoming a delta spike at 0/0. That's all that survives the sum.
Okay. I don't know if I'm being silly. I guess it's a, wait, what's, yeah, never mind.
If you think about it, and if you, yeah, let's talk about it. You want to think about it some more, or you want to, let's discuss it offline?
It's okay.
So, which gets us nu p converging weakly to mu. Weak star convergence. Well, I thought I would continue sort of a little bit in this excursion. We will come back to more things about Eisenstein series. But just to continue this excursion a little bit, here's another question. How random is modular multiplication? So we saw how random modular inversion is. It's very random. How random is modular multiplication? I.e., if I take a number and I map it to A times something, let's say, let's just call it B mod P. How random is this? Okay, so again, we can graph the pairs A over P, BA over P, mod 1.
I mean, you have a generator, right? Can't you like formulate it in terms of something like that?
Yeah, let's take a generator. Yeah, if B is a generator, that would be a good thing to do because otherwise, see, this is a very well-known pseudo-random number generator. So this map, okay, slightly more generally, the map A goes to A times something plus something mod P. This is called the linear congruential pseudo-random number generator. Pseudo-random number generator. So linear, this is a line. A is the variable, B is the slope, C is the intercept. Congruential is that we take mod something. Pseudorandom number generator. And so pseudorandom number generator means, like in video games, you want something that's extremely fast and looks like a random sequence, but of course it's not going to be an actual random sequence. It's going to be something deterministic that has that behaves randomly as far as humans can tell. And so you take a number, you multiply it by b, you add c, you reduce mod p. That gives you a new number. And you do it again and again and again, and that gives you a pseudorandom sequence. It's not random at all. It's completely deterministic, but it's hard to predict what the value of the next entry will be. So in fact, if we take, so we're taking the just the case c equals zero, the homogeneous case. So if c equals zero, then of course, you're multiplying by b every time to get as long a cycle as possible, you want b to be a generator. To get as long as possible cycle, need b to be a primitive root, a generator, right? In which case the sequence is 1, b, b squared, b cubed, and so on, up to b to the p minus 1, which gets you back to 1. That's Fermat's little theorem. Okay. And the randomness of this sequence, the presumed randomness of this sequence, in other words, you know every number mod p is going to arise somewhere on this sequence, right? So I tell you, where are you going to see 13? That's the discrete log problem. The randomness of this sequence is the discrete log problem, on which cryptosystems are based. You use this for cryptosystems. So you know it's hard, right? Systems. So you will not be able to tell me without doing a large computation, the most naive thing is to evaluate all of these and see which one of these is equal to 13. But just to show you, let's get another little picture here. If we take prime, okay, p is already some prime, 100th prime. What is, how do I get a primitive root out of Mathematica? Anybody know? Well, I could guess until I, so what's the mod, power mod
of you watch two? Will two be it?
That's what I want to see, yeah. Of p minus 1 over 2 mod p. Good. So 2 is a primitive root. And so let's look at the powers of 2. So table power mod 2 to the k mod p as k ranges from, I guess, 0 to p minus 1, or 1 to p minus 1. Okay, and let's take the pair k and this, and then let's list plot this. Okay, so again, two, we started with two here. This little dot is Fermat's little theorem. 2 to the p minus 1 is equal to 1. And otherwise, it's all over the place. Okay, let's make this slightly more square. Okay, and now let's take p equals 1,000. And let's try 3. Let's try 5. Wow.
As rare case, but there you go.
Yeah. Done. Yeah. Well, who knew that the 1,000th prime has its smallest primitive root is 7? Okay.
Analytic very improbable, actually.
Yeah. All right, so these are the values. And again, you might say these values are getting nicely distributed. You know, this looks like a really good pseudorandom sequence. So how good is this? Sequence? We know it's good because cryptosystems are based on the randomness of this sequence. But how good is it really? So the first test, kind of most naive test, of a sequence is the serial correlation in pairs. It's called serial correlation of pairs. In other words, I look at consecutive pairs, 1b, b, b squared, b squared, b cubed, and so on. So I look at b to the k mod p, and b to the k plus 1 mod p. And I look at these pairs. But of course, as b to the k ranges, I get all possible values here, and I just get b times that possible value here. In other words, it's exactly this graph. Okay, so if I take a primitive root, so let's look at this graph. We looked at the graph of this sequence. That sequence is nice and random. How about this sequence? So let's look at graph of A over P, B A over P in the two torus. Does that make sense?
What's the exponent of B in the second term on where you've written the serial correlation of pairs? Yeah, that.
Plus one.
Okay.
So you see a long sequence, right? You're playing your video game and you see B and then you see B squared and then you see B cubed. And so you have this, you see all these numbers. You're not just seeing them one at a time. You can sort of keep track of them. And so the first thing you might do is, can I guess what the next number is given the pair? I saw the previous pair, I saw the next pair, I saw this pair. Now I know this number, can I guess what the next number, roughly where that next number will be? Okay, so let's see how well we can do here. So if we take, instead of taking the powers, I just want k, two times k. All right, sorry, that was two. I want seven, I want the powers of seven. There we go. Well, how come we couldn't tell? This should have a periodicity that's much.
Yeah, the top looks like a little strange, huh?
Well, you see these three dots?
Yeah.
They reappear here.
Yeah.
So it looks like two has order p minus one over four. Oops. Is this divisible by eight? P minus one, 918. But we'll see in a second.
No wonder it looked a little fishy towards the top.
Yeah. So we wanted a seven here. Anyway.
I assume that was just too small of a 7919 was too small. I assume that's where that behavior was coming from. But no, this looks much better.
Okay, so let's get a random number of size. Let's do 5, 1, 2, 3. So it's a number of size 700. And one of these, it shouldn't take too long to find a primitive root. There we go. Okay, so 5125 is a primitive root mod 7918. So again, if I take powers of that, 5125, that's that dot right there. And then that dot right there is Fermat's little theorem. And then it's nice and random. And if I take the pair k and k times, let's call this the primitive root. That's a better way of doing it. K times the root mod p. Look at that. So again, what have I graphed? Well, what can I show you? Here, let me make this graph a little smaller. So I'm graphing the pairs k and k times this primitive root mod p. And so if I know, you see they're lying on these lines, it looks like. Well, of course it's a line. It forces the graph of a line, but the slope of that line is b over p. And p is a pretty large prime, but it looks like we only have to guess, like if you know the value of a, then you can guess the value of b up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 values. Like if I know, so this again, this is k, in this axis and k times the root b in this axis. So if I know the value of k, my guess for the y-axis is not one of 8,000. It's only one of 16. This is not a good pseudorandom number generator. Let's try another one. Let's find another root. How about, let's go a little farther. Good, so here's another root. How does its plot look? Oh, look at that. That's a much harder to tell sequence than this sequence. This sequence has 1 out of 16 values. This one, I can't even tell. So we got really lucky. This is a much better sequence.
Okay, wait a minute, what did you do different?
I just got a different, instead of the root being 5,125. So let me record this. Let me record what we did. We took the prime equal to, what's the prime? 7919. 7919. It's like the thousandth prime or something. Thousandth prime. We saw that we have two values, b1 and b2, that are both primitive roots. 5125 is a root. And right next to it is 5128 is a root. 5128 is also a root. Root. Too many O's. But when I look at the graph, at this graph here, I get just a couple of lines. And when I look at this graph in the second case, now I get dots all over.
It still did look like a bit like lines.
Well, it has to. It's going to be a line. But look at this. Somehow the slope, it's a very equidistributing line.
So I guess it's sort of like, what is the takeaway from this? That inversion is more complicated than translation?
Multiplication is more complicated than inversion. Because depends on what you're multiplying by. Sometimes you'll get something that where the serial correlation of pairs gives away almost everything that's going on, and sometimes not at all. So what makes this number so bad and this number so good? They're both primitive roots. They're of the same size. It's not about the size.
Wait, so what you're saying is good for a crypto system is like a really high slope, is what you're saying?
Not high, but one that equidistributes. I don't even know which one. I mean, my eye is telling me that it's this, but for all I know, it's this, but it's jumping around. It's a slope that looks like it's equidistributing.
Oh, okay. So you're saying that we might be having some optical illusions here?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Both of these slopes are almost, you know, seven-fifths or five-sevenths or something, right? The slopes are both five-sevenths.
These plots do pass the vertical line test.
They all pass the vertical line test, exactly. Yes.
Very much an optical illusion.
yes, of course, this is an optical illusion. Yeah. Even this one, there's only one value for any value down here. It's just that they cluster in this way. And so you get a lot more information about where the next value might be than you would otherwise. So why is this happening? Any guesses? What's
arithmetic?
What's that?
Number theory.
Number theory, absolutely. Absolutely. Absolutely number theory. What about number theory?
It's going to be like Kloosterman sums again?
It's not going to be Kloosterman sums. It'll be something else. So if we want to understand these slopes, let's look at these slopes. One slope is 5125 over 7919, and the other slope is 5128 over 7919. They're nearly identical as far as their Archimedean behavior.
Is there going to be some sort of continued fraction?
Aha, there we go. Let's get the continued fraction. continued fraction expansion of, what was the first one? 5125? 5125 over 7919? Okay, so this continued fraction, of course, it starts with zero because the number is already less than one, and it goes 1115. Somebody tell me. So it starts with zero, then 111 528 28 115. Okay, but in other words, this number
is like a Zaremba conjecture.
That's where we're going. That's where we're going. Okay, so we have 1 over 1 plus 1 over 1 plus 1 over 1 plus 1 over 5 plus 1 over 28 plus 1 over 1 plus 1 over 15. Okay, where is the other slope? If I just change that 5 to an 8, very nearly the same thing, its continued fraction goes 11156. Zero, 11156. 1, 3, 1, come on. 1, 3, 2, 7.
I guess 28 is a big number.
28 is a huge number. So what's really going on is that 28 is basically like infinity. And infinity, you see, every continued fraction actually has an infinity at the end. Why do I say that?
You mean as in like it repeats? Like, or like,
no, every continued fraction of a rational number.
Yeah. Okay, so the denominator clears.
Once you hit zero, right? You take off, what do? You flip this number, and then that gives you, and the integer part of that gives you the first number that you subtract off, right? How do you compute this continued fraction? So this is less than one, so you flip it. You flip it, and I get 7919 over 5125. The integer part of that is 1. So I subtract off the integer part. So I get 7919 minus 5125 over 5125. That's going to be a number less than 1. So I flip that. And then I take the floor. And now the next floor is 1. And I keep doing that until I get to 0. And then I'm supposed to flip that and take the integer part. And that's infinity. So you don't write the infinity, you just stop.
So is that the end of each of those continued fractions? Does it terminate after that many?
It terminates, that's exactly.
Oh, okay. So that's precise. That's not like
that's,
the first.
That's precise. And that's because this is a rational number. Every rational number has a terminated continued fraction.
Okay. So hang on. And say again about how we compute. Oh, okay. So if it's less than one, we flip it.
Yep. In other words, that's what these one overs are doing.
Yep. And then we get a value, and then we subtract the denominator times that value from the numerator. It'll be less than one, so we flip it.
Yep.
I see.
And that is okay. So this is the sequence of partial quotients. These are called the partial quotients. Partial quotients.
So it's like if you wait, so 5128 is what we were calling better.
Yes.
Right. So if we keep testing for primitive roots and say that the highest number is then 6 instead of 7, you'd expect it to be even better.
Even better.
Okay. So if you took like all ones, right, as if you were like approximating 5, right?
Yeah.
Or something like that, then she gets something crazy.
If we take the, so if we take all ones, that's Fibonacci numbers. Fibonacci 1000. Oops, that's a little too big. Let's go 100. Okay, so if I take Fibonacci 100, now I don't know if this is prime. It doesn't really have to be, but we could take the same table and we can take the same table and we're going to multiply by Fibonacci 100 and reduce mod Fibonacci 101 as we go from 1 to Fibonacci 101. Oh, come on. What's the matter? Let's take it down a notch from 10 to 11. That's a pretty nice set of grid points. How about 20 to 21? How's that for a collection of grid points that you can't even tell isn't uniform? So the point is the ratio, we're multiplying by the 20th Fibonacci number and reducing mod the 21st Fibonacci number. And so the slope is the ratio of the 20th Fibonacci number to the 21st. That is what it is. The continued fraction of this is all ones. This two at the end is really a 1-1. Okay, so that's what's going to have this this best possible. So the other thing we did, and I have to let you go, and we'll pick up next time. We looked at the nth Fibonacci number divided by the n plus first Fibonacci number, which has continued fraction all ones. But for some finite amount, then you add another one and you get the next pair. You add another one, you get the next pair. Okay, so the point is this 28 is as good as infinity. 28 is so big, it may as well be infinity.
In our eyes.
Yeah. For our eyes, exactly.
Well, it's sort of like saying that this fraction is pretending to be a fraction of much smaller denominator.
Exactly, right? It's pretending to be this fraction. So if I take from continued fraction of this sequence, 0, 1, 1, 1, 5, it's pretending to be a fraction with denominator 17. So this number is very close, as far as arithmetic is concerned, this is very close to 11 17ths. And if I look at the graph, here's the-
Those are the 16 lines or something, right?
Yeah, exactly.
17.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So what is it, 11 17ths? Let's make this nice and small. Okay. So, well, it's hard to see at this scale, but the point is, that's why there's 16 lines. Because really, there's only like 17 choices.
Does the position where that 28 appears matter, like whether it's towards the front or towards the end of the sequence? I have no intuition for continued fractions.
So if it's towards the front, then it's even, so the fact that that 28 is, you can think of it as infinity, means you can throw out the complexity of the rest of the number.
So having a large number further, like where the, like if that 28 was a 3, we'd still have that 15.
Yes.
A couple terms later, but that 15 is far enough down that it just doesn't matter.
That the denominator doesn't reduce
the complexity very much.
That the denominator that best approximates this fraction will still be very large. Whereas the 28 cuts that denominator at a much smaller value.
Okay.
Okay.
So is it worse to have like a 28 in that position or something like a 10 in the position before?
That depends on what the numbers before it were.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. But I should let you go. Let me let you go. And we will pick up with just a touch of Zaremba's conjecture and some analytic things about Zaremba's conjecture. But I thought it was a natural thing to talk about after discussing Kloosterman sums.